taking your seats, I want to invite you to turn in your Bibles to the Old Testament book of Habakkuk, and we'll continue this journey through the minor prophets. This morning we're focusing on the book of Habakkuk, and if you don't have a Bible, we'd love to present you a copy of God's Word. Please see me. I'll be outside at the end of the service at the tent on the way to the big parking lot. Or one of the pastors would be glad to put a Bible in your hand. And if you need a Bible in this service, there's one in the chair in front of you. And you'll find that book on page 785. Some of you are probably ready to put your Bible down and just get that Bible since you know the page number. But 785, the book of Habakkuk. I just have to echo what was said a moment ago by Stephen about this summer. It's been an amazing summer. I am so grateful for how the Lord has blessed His church. The summer just flew by, but going back to VBS Remix, we're focusing on the children in our church, trying to go a little bit deeper in discipleship, but it's open to the community, and we had guests every night. We had people from the community. A great VBS, the Sermon on the Mount event was a huge success, if I could use that term. God used that very warm night out here in this field as we saw through this brother's ministry how God works in our lives to shape us and mold us, even when we are oftentimes not cooperative with His purposes and His ways. And then Connect Camps, I feel like we're still seeing fruit from that, the blessing of those 5 days, and what a joy to know that there were children saved and reached during that time. And then Friday evening, I was blown away to see so many people coming across the parking lots about 20 till 6. It looked like a bus pulled up, or two buses, as people were coming. So We're grateful for this summer. All right, well, I want to introduce the book of Habakkuk by asking you some questions. And these obviously are questions that you would just answer in your heart. You don't need to certainly answer this out loud. But in your heart, let me throw a few questions at you to consider. And this will help us understand this book a little bit better. And by the way, I didn't say this, but I said it earlier in the first service that the songs are always so rich, but the song Sovereign Over Us, if you looked up those words, I think that gives a good description of the book of Habakkuk. It helps set Habakkuk for us and helps us to understand it. But here are my questions. Number one, have you ever believed God would not answer your prayer? Have you ever just believed God is not answering this prayer? God hasn't answered this prayer. I have prayed. I've poured out my heart. I've asked others to pray. And it's like my prayer has hit the ceiling. Or maybe it doesn't even get to the ceiling. You ever felt that way? That you needed something? You begged God for something? You prayed hard, and God did not answer your prayer. Here's another one. Have you ever complained to God? I mean, have you just ever been sideways with the Lord? God was not responding the way you wanted Him to. Something was going on in your life, and it's kind of like, God, why? Why is this happening? Or why is this not happening? So have you ever just maybe you could call it a pity party, but you've just complained to the Lord. Ever been there? Third question, similar to the first two. Have you ever just had hard questions for the Lord that God was not answering? Maybe raw questions. Maybe you felt raw. You just felt on the inside a sense that God was no longer there. He's no longer listening to you. Your faith just felt raw. And your relationship to God and your Your questions were not answered and your relationship became one of struggle. Have you ever questioned God or doubted His goodness? You're going to hear me say that God can handle questions. I used to hear people say, don't question God. You can't question God. And while I understand the root of that statement, I understand the meaning of it, I want you to know God can handle our questions. And that's what the book of Habakkuk reveals. This book, this short three-chapter book, in this journey through the minor prophets, as we come to Habakkuk, we're thinking about the message in the mess. And the mess this time is similar to Jonah. It's the prophet. He's struggling. He's complaining. He's doubting. He's questioning the ways of God. And this book is really a dialogue between the prophet Habakkuk and God as the prophet presents his complaints and reveals his doubts. He deals with the age-old question, how do we make sense of a cruel, hard world and a good and gracious God? I'm going to use the outline from Rockin's Bible Handbook. I had my sermon prepared. I had my own outline. And I pulled that book. I went in the library. Tell you again, we've got some great resources in our library. We've got a great bookstall. We've also got some great study resources in the church library. I encourage you to use it. Rockin's Bible Handbook, as I was reading what this book said about, really after all my preparation was done, just kind of wanted to look at one more thing, and I liked his outline of the book. So I'm using it. Credit goes to the Rockin's Bible Handbook, the outline that you have in your notes there. So let's work through this book, and again, as in the other journeys through the minor prophets, the other books we've looked at, the aim is not just to get a historical setting or context, but to see how this book relates to where we are today. So keep those questions sort of in the back of your mind. Have you ever complained to God? Have you ever prayed and felt like God didn't hear it? Have you ever questioned God? Have you ever doubted His goodness? Have you ever just felt raw or had raw questions about faith? Well, that's Habakkuk. And let's begin. Habakkuk's first question. Habakkuk is troubled. He's troubled by the fact that his nation, Judah, has been crumbling morally. And he's complaining to God. And his complaint centers on what seems to be that God is unconcerned. By the way, I should have said this, but on those questions when I said, have you ever, and I had three or four questions, for the vast majority of us in this room, if we're honest, the answer to every one of those questions was yes. If you were answering yes to those questions and thought you're an anomaly, that you're off, you're not unique. We have all questioned, we've all doubted, we've all had seasons where our faith felt raw, where we believed our prayers were unheard or unanswered, that God was not listening to us. And so we can all, I think, relate to Habakkuk. So Habakkuk's complaint centers on what appeared or what seemed to him the unconcern of God. He just believes God's no longer concerned. So let's look at it. Chapter 1, verse 1. The oracle that Habakkuk the prophet saw. O Lord, how long shall I cry for help and you will not hear? Or cry to you violence and you will not save? Why do you make me see iniquity? And why do you idly look at wrong? Destruction and violence are before me. Strife and contention arise. So the law is paralyzed and justice never goes forth. For the wicked surround the righteous, so justice goes forth perverted. What is he saying? He's asking God a hard question. How long am I going to cry out to help, God, and you're going to ignore me? That's how he feels. His prayers seem unanswered in verse 2. In verse 3 and 4, sin seems unnoticed by God. God does appear that he's just idle, that he's just not observing, that he's not paying attention. Habakkuk sees his nation where there's violence, there's strife, there's contention, and God is idle. God is not noticing it. The law that was to be the schoolmaster to ultimately point people to Christ, the law is suffering from paralysis in Habakkuk's mind. And so Habakkuk is asking these questions, concerned about the violence and the lawlessness that rules the day and the evil that abounded and the fact that God was silent and doing nothing. I wonder if I speak to someone that's where you are, or someone comes to your mind that you love, maybe someone in your own family, someone who's a friend, someone you work with, and that's the way as you're engaging with them, that's where they are. They feel like God has just passed them by. So Habakkuk doesn't understand the ways of God. He's asking questions. And I want to say it again. God was not thrown off by Habakkuk's questions. And friends, when you have hard questions, God can handle your questions. God is not going to be thrown off kilter if you ask him hard questions, if you complain. Now, it ought not to be a steady diet of complaints. It ought not become a way of life. But if you're in a season where your faith is hard and challenged and your prayers seem to be unanswered and you're struggling and you're troubled and you complain to God and you express in honest agony where you are in prayer, God is not going to fall off of his throne. So let's look at God's first answer. It comes in verse 5. Look among the nations and see, wonder and be astounded. For I'm doing a work in your days that you would not believe if told. For behold, I am raising up the Chaldeans, that bitter and hasty nation, who march through the breadth of the earth to seize dwellings not their own. They are dreaded and fearsome. Their justice and dignity go forth from themselves. Their horses are swifter than leopards, more fierce than the evening wolves. Their horsemen press proudly on. Their horsemen come from afar. They fly like an eagle swift to devour. They all come for violence, all their faces forward. They gather captives like sand. At kings they scoff, and at rulers they laugh. They laugh at every fortress, for they pile up earth and take it. Then they sweep by like the wind and go on, guilty men whose own might is their God. What is God's answer? It's going to surprise you. Maybe hard to pick up in the first time through those verses 5 through 11. But here's what's going on. The Assyrian Empire, the world's dominating power nation of the time, was falling off the world stage. It was losing its place of power and prestige and prominence. Two powers were vying to overtake Assyria and move into the world's dominating leader, Egypt and Babylon. Babylon would win the day in 605 when Nebuchadnezzar would rise to power, and Babylon would become the ruling force of the world. Babylon was a brutal nation. You say, I didn't see Babylon in there. Well, look at the end of verse 5. The Chaldeans, that's a reference to Babylon. It's another name for Babylon. So to Habakkuk's complaint, to Habakkuk's struggle, how long, God, am I going to cry for help and you will not answer? How long am I going to beg you to do something and see all the violence and strife and contention around me and get no answer? God's answer, God's response, his first answer to Habakkuk is a bit surprising. What does he say he's going to do? Verse 6, he's raising up Babylonians. Now Habakkuk is in a tailspin. He was troubled, and now God's answer has, at least in this moment, brought more trouble into his life. Because the answer to why are you not answering my prayers and doing something about this wicked people in my land who are not listening to the prophets, who are creating more and more strife and contention and violence, God says, I'm going to raise up an enemy that's very much known for their brutality and their wickedness, and they're going to come like wolves in the night. They're going to be swift as leopards. Their army is going to just wipe Judah out. It's going to be razed. It's going to be just utter devastation. And this is mind-boggling for Habakkuk, God's answer. His answer in this hard time in his life. Judah is bad. Judah is sinning. But compared to the Babylonians, they're like someone who's run through a stop sign and they're pulled over and they're arrested and they're brought before a corrupt judge who gives them a life sentence for running a stop sign. That's maybe one way you could think of it. To use the Babylonians, this evil empire, this bitter and hasty nation who just goes far and near, here and yon, and anybody that gets in their way, they take them out. This is beyond Habakkuk's ability to understand. So it makes no sense to him. It leads him to his second question, beginning in verse number 12 of chapter 1. And it goes through chapter 2, verse 1. Follow along. This is his second question. Are you not from everlasting, O Lord, my God, my Holy One? He's saying what he knows about God. He's the eternal God. Is that not you? Is that not the God that I believed in and followed? We shall not die, O Lord. You have ordained them as a judgment, and you, O rock, have established them for reproof. He can't believe it. You who are of pure eyes and to see evil and cannot look at wrong, why do you idly look at traitors and remain silent when the wicked swallows up the man more righteous than he? In Habakkuk's mind, Judah was surely bad. Yes, they were bad. But the Babylonians are far worse. God, how can you do this? How can you use someone so evil and so brutal as the Babylonians? Verse 14, you make mankind like the fish of the sea, like crawling things that have no ruler. He brings all of them up with a hook. He drags them out with his net. This is the description of the Babylonian army, this army of terrorists. The Babylonians would invade, and they would capture enemies, and they would put big fish hooks in their mouths. It was brutal. It was painful. It was humiliating. And they would drag them, parade them through their streets as they brought a train of prisoners home. And this is what they do. He drags them out with his net. He gathers them in his dragnet. There's no escaping. They're caught. They're trapped. He rejoices and is glad. Therefore, he sacrifices to his net and makes offerings to his dragnet. For by them he lives in luxury and his food is rich. Is he then to keep on emptying his net and mercilessly killing nations forever? God, is this what's going to happen? Is this what you're going to let happen in my world? That's what Habakkuk's asking. Verse 1, chapter 2, I will take my stand at my watchpost and station myself on the tower and look out to see what he will say to me and what I will answer concerning my complaint. This is where some of us have been. Some of you may be today. You're complaining to God. You're questioning God. You're doubting God. You've cried out to God for answers. No answers have come. It may have nothing to do with an enemy or an enemy nation for sure. It may be in your own home. It may be in your workplace. It may be in your school. It may be something in with your siblings. But boy, there's something, and it's like there's a big fish hook in your mouth, or you're trapped in a dragnet you cannot get out of. And this is what God's answer seems to be. God just seems to not give you any hope. And so Habakkuk says, I'm going to just take my place and see what will happen here. Let's go to Habakkuk's second question. Habakkuk, well, actually, go back to verse 13 for just a moment. You who are of pure eyes and to see evil and cannot look at wrong. Just to highlight that again, this is what Habakkuk cannot understand. How can God look on this? So he's struggling with this and he's troubled. And God is now going to give him yet a second answer. I misspoke a moment ago. We're on that part of the outline. God's second answer starts in chapter 2, verse 2. And it goes through the end of the chapter. I'm not going to read the entirety of the chapter, but I do want to look at the first five verses. So God is working in this prophet's circumstance. He's not answering the way he wants. Habakkuk is troubled. Now God's giving yet another answer. Verse 2. And the Lord answered me, write the vision, make it plain on tablets, so he may run who reads it. For still the vision awaits its appointed time. It hastens to the end. It will not lie. If it seems slow, wait for it. It will surely come. It will not delay. If you're taking notes, I would jot down Habakkuk 2, verse 3, and that word wait. At least that's the word in the English Standard Version from which I'm preaching. That's a key concept here. Wait. W-A-I-T. This is what the Lord is telling Habakkuk. Habakkuk, I know you don't understand this. I'm doing something in your day you would not ever figure out or understand. But Habakkuk, here's what you're going to have to do. You're going to have to do something none of us like to do. You're going to have to wait. Anybody in this room enjoy waiting? Anybody enjoy long lines? Anybody enjoy calling a company and get a recording and then hearing something to the effect of your wait time will be approximately 33 minutes? Like what? Who's going to wait? I'm not going to do that. No, we don't like to wait. But this is what the Lord is saying. Wait. We sung this earlier. You are working in our waiting. God is working in our waiting. He's sanctifying us. So to Habakkuk, you're going to have to wait. And it was going to be a long wait. It was going to be 70 long years before God would deal with the Babylonians. God would raise up a new world power. God would raise up a new king, a new ruler, but the answer initially is wait. And church, let me say it again, waiting is hard. But there are times that we grow best when we wait. There are times, that is one of those times, when we have to wait, God can do something in our lives. Sometimes when we're still, when we're slowing down. Most of us are running so fast and looking at our phones and planning this and scheduling that and making sure we didn't forget that we forget how crucial it is to just pause and wait on the Lord. When we're still, God really is able to speak to us. But there's another lesson, and it's another key word, and it comes in the next verse. And it's the word faith. So those are two words I want you to please get. Wait and then the word faith. Behold, his soul is puffed up. It is not upright within him. That's the Babylonians. The Babylonians are swollen with pride, and proud people don't need God. Proud people don't need to lean on anyone or anything. Proud people take the bull by the horns. Proud people say, I am the captain of my fate. I can do it. And that's what the soul of the Babylonian was. It was arrogantly, pridefully set on doing things its way. But that's not the righteous. And this is a key Old Testament verse. The righteous shall live by his faith. This is the key word, faith. The righteous shall live by his faith. Habakkuk, you're going to have to trust me. That's God's word to him. You're going to have to wait. It's going to be hard. And you're just going to have to trust me, Habakkuk. You're just going to have to see that I'm doing something that you're not going to figure out. You're not going to understand it. But God's plan is far bigger than our immediate circumstances. And friends, I just want to give that word to you this morning, that in your and mine and your circumstances and stations and situations in life, there are just those seasons that God says, wait. I'm not going to tell you the answer. You're not going to see the answer, maybe for a long time. And you're going to have to learn to trust me, God is saying to us. Trust me. That phrase, by the way, the righteous shall live by his faith, is so important. It reminds us of so much of the Old Testament that it's not just old stories. It's pointing us to the cross. It's pointing us to Jesus. That phrase is used 3 times in the New Testament. The righteous shall live by faith. Let me give you one. Galatians chapter 3, verse 11. Now it is evident that no one is justified before God by the law, for the righteous shall live by faith. What is Paul saying? What was Habakkuk dimly looking ahead to? We're saved by faith. We're made right with God, not by our works, but by our faith, our trust in Jesus Christ. The law has no power to save. The law can't convert anyone. It can never make anyone right with God. The only way to be made right with God is through faith in God's Son. When we move into verse number 6 of this chapter, there are 5 woes. I won't read those, but if you want to circle the verse number, verse 6, verse 9, verse 12, verse 15, and 16. A woe, when you see that in the Bible, is an exclamation of judgment on others. And God reveals that eventual judgment will come to the Babylonians. I'll just give you one, verse 12 through 14. Woe to him who builds a town with blood and founds a city on iniquity. You can scan over verse 13 and 14. Judgment's coming to Babylon. It's going to come. Habakkuk, you're going to have to wait on it, but it'll come. If you build a town with blood, if you found a city on iniquity, judgment is coming. This takes us into chapter 3, which is Habakkuk's Psalm of Faith. Let's look at this chapter. Verse 1. A prayer of Habakkuk the prophet according to the Shigionoth. This could possibly refer to a song. It could be a tune. It could be a musical setting. It obviously has something to do with music because the chapter ends with the words to the choir master with stringed instruments. So there's a prayer in chapter 3. It's Habakkuk's prayer. And perhaps it is that Habakkuk wanted this prayer sung. I must tell you, I don't generally sing my prayers, but a lot of what we do sing is an expression of faith and trust in God. It's an expression of our dependence on God. And so Habakkuk is pouring his heart out to the Lord here, and perhaps because what we sing, we often remember. Perhaps he's got a musical note to this or something to do with music so that it's embedded in the minds of those who hear it. So he pours his heart out to God in prayer, And then the book closes with some of the most amazing words in the Minor Prophets, if not the entire Bible, at least an amazing word about faith. I have always loved the end of the book of Habakkuk. And I must tell you that even back many years before I had really grown some in my understanding of the Minor Prophets, I knew about these verses. But now knowing them in their setting, in their historical context, and what's behind these words, they're even more meaningful. Hear the word of the Lord in chapter 3, verse 17. Though the fig tree should not blossom, nor fruit be on the vines, the produce of the olive fail, and the fields yield no food, the flock be cut off from the fold, and there be no herd in the stalls, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will take joy in the God of my salvation. God, the Lord, is my strength. He makes my feet like the deer's. He makes me tread upon high places. In three brief chapters in our English Bible, Habakkuk has gone from God, what are you doing? And God, why are you not responding? And God, do you not see what's going on around me? In essence, God, do you not care about the fact that we are treated like insects? And God, now you're saying you're going to use a wicked nation to punish us? He's moved from those kinds of complaints to amazing trust and faith. I don't know how long this is. It doesn't take very long to read Habakkuk chapter 1, verse 1 through chapter 3, verse 19. So I don't know how long it took him to get here. But what is he saying? Habakkuk is saying in verse 17, the most essential necessity that we have in life is food. And look at it. God, if there's nothing in the cabinets, if the grocery store shelves are empty, if the stores are closed down, maybe a better way that we could understand it, if there's nothing to be purchased, nothing anyone has, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. This is a picture of faith, friends. And children, by the way, if you're struggling with unscrambling the puzzle, many of the words are found in verse 17 through 19. So if the back of that sermon guide for children is tripping you up, look closely in those verses. So Habakkuk's moved from great doubt to great faith. And church, I want us to do that. I want some of us to move from doubts and complaining to God and questioning God to saying, God, I don't know how, but even if the fig tree should not blossom and there's no fruit on the vines, even if there's nothing that I can tangibly point to and say, God is still good, I'm going to rejoice in you. And the only way Habakkuk could do that is faith. So he moves from virtually no faith to great faith. So how will I respond? Well, Habakkuk would tell us to pray. He gave us the example, although we didn't read it, the first part of chapter 3. He teaches us we have to trust God. We have to wait. We saw that. Again, verse 4, chapter 2, a key verse. Habakkuk is really pointing us, like all the Bible, like all the Old Testament, it's pointing us to the gospel. We're doing everything we can with our children and our teenagers to show that the Bible and our adults, the Bible points us to Jesus. And that's what Habakkuk is. It's putting the spotlight on trusting in the Lord Jesus Christ. Friends, the Bible teaches that we've all broken God's law. We've all sinned. We've all turned away from God. There's none righteous, no, not one. We are all deserving of judgment. But God sent Jesus into the world and he took our judgment for us. God judged our sin in the person of His Son. And for all who will repent and all who will believe, Jesus' sacrifice, Jesus' death is applicable to the one who will believe. If you will turn from a self-governed, self-directed life and believe on Christ, rely on Him alone, He will save you. You will be reborn and He will start transforming you and changing you. And you may have a lot of rough edges. Your growth may be slow. The changes may come slow. They probably will. But God will work and God will start changing your spiritual taste buds. And things that right now some may think, well, I could never stop that, or I could never enjoy that or stop enjoying that. You may go back to some things, but things that once made you happy and that you thought were so good, it's going to be like something that you put in your mouth that at once you enjoyed. Maybe you remembered it from your childhood and like, that doesn't taste good anymore. Sin doesn't taste the same. It's something begins to change. And that's what the gospel does. It changes us. And it's the good news that all who repent and believe can and will be saved. And maybe you've never been saved. Boys and girls, maybe I speak to a child, elementary school or a middle schooler, a high schooler, and you've not yet been saved. You've not yet believed on Jesus. You've not yet come to Jesus and said, I need you, save me. I want to appeal to you. Come to Jesus. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. It's simple. This isn't rocket science. This is a simple matter of acknowledging your sin and that Jesus is the only Savior and trusting Him, and He will save you. Some have never been baptized. I speak to some this morning. Perhaps you've never publicly confessed your faith in Jesus Christ through believer's baptism. I would ask you, what in the world are you waiting on? I've used this story illustration so many times, but I think it helps. This wedding band, imagine if on my wedding night, I took this wedding band off and I told my wife, I don't really want, it's okay that we're together, but I don't want anybody to know I'm married. I'd rather this just be something between us and not let others know. This is a universal symbol of marriage. So all men, all women, maybe there's reasons some cannot wear a wedding band, but everybody knows what it means. Imagine someone, and maybe it's you, that says, I just don't want to go be baptized. What you're really saying is, I don't want to identify publicly as a believer. Because that is your confession of faith. Confession of faith is believer's baptism. That's when you publicly confess you're believing in the Lord Jesus Christ. So if you've never been baptized, I hope you'll speak to one of the pastors this morning. And let's have a conversation about your professing your faith in Jesus. We come now to the Lord's table. And by the way, when you came in this morning, if you did not pick up one of these packets, let me first say that what we're doing is for believers. And if you are a baptized believer in good standing with this or some local church, we invite you and encourage you to join with us in participating in the Lord's Supper. Parents, guide your children. If they have not professed faith in Jesus and been baptized, then that leads to a conversation that you can have later. And if you're an adult and you're not a Christian, or you're not in good standing in your church, then we would encourage you to refrain from partaking of the Lord's Supper. But with that said, when you came in this morning, somehow you missed these, and it's easy to do, please hold your hand up. The men in the back have these. If you'll hold your hand up, guys, all right, they're making their way down the aisle, and we want to make sure that everyone gets one of these in their hands. Keep your hands up for them, please, and they will get it to you. There are three passages in the Gospels, in the Synoptics, in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, where Jesus gave instructions to his disciples about this supper. And in each of those, he explained what it is and how this is to be carried out, and that in partaking the bread and partaking the fruit of the vine, that we are not ingesting Jesus, we're not getting Jesus into us, but we are remembering what he did for us. We are celebrating his sacrifice. The Lord's Supper directs our attention back to the cross. When we come to this time, we're looking back to what Jesus did for us. So I encourage you to do that. Reflect on Christ's sacrifice, not on your struggles, not on your failures. And that's another trick of Satan. Oh, you're not worthy of doing this. You're a bad Christian. You've not had a good week or a good couple of weeks. You're not worthy. If you're redeemed and trusting in Jesus, it's his worthiness. So reflect on what he did. The Lord's Supper encourages us to look ahead to the second coming, to anticipate his return. As we ingest the wafer and the juice, we do so in anticipation of that day when we will drink it anew in heavenly kingdom. So we look ahead to his coming. But it also provides a time for self-examination. And one means we have of self-examination is our church covenant. So please take the hymn book out of the chair in front of you, turn to the inside cover, and let's read it from our hymn book. Maybe let's hold up on putting it on the screen, and let's just all read from the hymn book. And it's on the inside cover, the Woolsey Baptist Church Covenant. Incidentally, while not in print here, everything in this statement has a scriptural foundation. There's a biblical foundation for every statement here. And if you're interested in that, please let me know, or one of the pastors, and we'll get you a copy of it. But as we read this in unison, we're reading it to ourselves, we're reading it one to another, and we're reading it as a reminder of self-examination. So we do so with this preamble that reminds us that we're relying on God's gracious aid to do these things. Shall we read together? Having, as we trust, been brought by divine grace to repent and believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and to submit our lives wholeheartedly to him, and having been baptized upon our profession of faith in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, we do now, relying on his gracious aid, solemnly and joyfully renew our covenant with each other. We will work and pray for the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. We will walk together in brotherly love, as do the members of a Christian church, exercise an affectionate care and watchfulness over each other, and faithfully admonish and entreat one another as occasion may require. We will not forsake the assembling of ourselves together, nor neglect to pray for ourselves and others. We will endeavor to maintain family and personal devotions, to bring up all who are under our care in the nurture and admonition of the Lord, and by a pure and loving example, to seek the salvation of our family and friends. We will rejoice at each other's happiness and endeavor with tenderness and sympathy to bear each other's burdens and sorrows. We will seek, by divine aid, to live carefully in the world, denying ungodliness and worldly lust, remembering that we have been buried with Christ in baptism and raised to walk in newness of life. We will work together to maintain a faithful evangelical ministry in this church as we sustain its worship, ordinances, discipline, and doctrines. We will contribute cheerfully and regularly to the support of the ministry, the expenses of the church, the relief of the poor, and the spread of the gospel to all nations. We will, when we move from this place, as soon as possible, with some other church where we can carry out the spirit of this covenant and the principles of God's Word. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen. So, the packet that you have, if you would, peel back that first layer and take out the wafer. This is a reminder of the broken body of our Lord Jesus, and He said that we are to do this in remembrance of Him. The Bible tells us that without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness. But praise God, because of the shed blood of Jesus, blood that He gave, we are cleansed from all sin. We are forgiven of all sins, past, present, and future. And we rejoice in His perfect sacrifice. And as Jesus passed that cup and told His disciples to drink of this, we do so in remembrance of what He did on our behalf. Paul said, as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until He comes. When we partake of these elements, we are reminding ourselves that Jesus died for sinners to reconcile them to God. How grateful we should be for Jesus, our Redeemer. I'm going to ask that we just bow our heads and take a moment for silent prayer and reflection to just consider the book of Habakkuk. Perhaps you need to learn, and I need to learn, to wait, to trust. Perhaps you want to just reread those last few verses as you pray and meditate. Thank Him for His sacrifice on your behalf. Let's pray together, church. While our heads are bowed and we are in a spirit of prayer, if anyone would like to speak with me about becoming a Christian or being baptized or any other spiritual decision you want to make, please see me outside under the tent or, again, one of the other pastors. But this is the invitation that we extend: to come to Jesus, believe on Christ. And we would love to speak with you about how to make that decision today. Now, Lord, we praise You for the book of Habakkuk and for the great lessons that You unfold for us through this prophet. And God, we're thankful for the fact that Habakkuk points us to the cross, that the righteous will live by his faith. And Father, I pray this morning for anyone under the sound of my voice who has not yet trusted in Your Son for his or her salvation, that even today, Lord, he or she would. If there's a child, a teenager, an adult who is not yet saved, God, would You draw that person to Yourself? If someone here today, Lord, is walking in a guilty distance from You, their hearts become hard and cold, cynical, indifferent, God, would You show him, show her how much You gave for his or her life, that You love her, You love him, that You're the God who restores, that You're the God who renews. Father, if there's one in the room this morning, one listening online who's going through a period of doubt and questions, I pray that the message of Habakkuk in this man who moved from questions to faith would be reflected in his or her heart. Thank You, Lord Jesus, that you are our Redeemer. Oh, how we praise you that there is a Redeemer. That you, God, gave your own Son to save us from our sin. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand together, church, as we sing what we believe.